Game of Thrones tends to use a lot of different literary references or terms, and one of those terms is the Chekhov's gun. It basically means that you don't put something in a scene, since we're referring to the TV show, it originally referred to most likely books and plays, but you don't place something in a scene without it meaning something later, and if there is something like that, you completely cut it out. So Game of Thrones has done that with a few different things. One thing from Game of Thrones Season 7 was not placed by mistake, and that thing is the paintings on the wall. Let's discuss what they mean and who these figures represent. Before we get started, I am actually having a giveaway which ends in exactly one day from now, so make sure you go enter the contest. There's a link down below called gleam.io. Click that link and go enter all the bonus ways. The main way to do so is by subscribing here on the channel, leaving a comment down below. Make sure you have your notifications turned on so that way you get alerted every time I drop a video. And also, make sure you like this video. The main image that I want to focus on, because when we're actually shown this scene, when Jon is walking Daenerys through the cave, when they initially get to the cave paintings, we're not really shown a clear shot. And this is like the Chekhov's gun, the intentional thing that was placed in this scene that's going to pay off later. I think this is basically showing us the very end of the final battle. Now, I'm not saying the very end of the politics and the game, you know, the game to win the actual Iron Throne. We're not going to see that in this cave painting, but we're going to see the end of the Long Night 2.0, or the prevention of the Long Night 2.0. Now, if you'll notice, in a lot of these images, when we are shown them clearly from the light that's reflecting off Jon's torch, there's only a few of them that are actually lit up well enough so that we can actually have a screen grab from them. Before we dig into this, there was a lot of theories that were floating around when Season 7 was actually happening. One of those main theories was, since this was one of the images that we had gotten, you know, a well enough shot of, or a lit up enough shot of, a lot of people thought that the image on the far left was Jaime, simply because it had a line drawn through his hand. Now, if you'll notice, every single image, including the five figurines behind the main three up front, have some weird sort of, like, they're drawn with probably a dull blade. Maybe a sharp blade, but by the time they finished, it was dull. So there's a lot of, like, you know, miss strokes or whatever you want to call it with the metal hitting the rock on the wall. So something as simple as a line drawn through the forearm of the far left figurine, thinking that it's Jaime, is rather silly. If you'll notice on the left side of that, he is wielding his blade. This figure is wielding his blade with his left hand. So a lot of people are saying, you know, Jaime is now left-handed since his right hand was cut. That's another reason why. But I don't necessarily think that Jaime will be in that final, like, we killed the Night King group of people. I do think he's going to play a heavy role, but I don't think he's going to be on the very front lines. What I mean by that, before I go into it in this video, you can actually click this link right up here, and that'll take you to a video I did a few days back. But in that video, I explained that Jaime's battle commander expertise is going to be put to good use. He's likely going to be the strong general that Jon Snow and Daenerys need moving forward to try to fight the Night King. I think he may not be present in the very first battle, which I'll talk about later on in this video, but he will definitely play a heavy hand in the final battle in which the Night King is actually killed. But you can click that link right up here, and that'll take you to that video for a more in-depth explanation of my Jaime Lannister commander to Jon Snow theory. So when we're running down all of the characters who could play these three main individuals up front, it's honestly, four. Before we get too carried away, if you'll notice, there's a small little ball right up there in between the middle and the far right person. That, I think that actually looks like an eye, more so than a line drawn through a character's arm, meaning that it means a character missing, you know, a limb. I think that that eye represents Bran. Bran is Bloodraven, also known as the Three-Eyed Crow. Bran is definitely going to have a hand in finally killing the Night King.
To further add on to that, we do know that Bran being a green seer, an eye can definitely represent the ability to see everything. Which is why you have the crows that represent Bloodraven with the third eye, the all-seeing eye in the middle of the forehead, awakened.
I think Bran will in fact hold down the Night King in the Weirwood net, like he will be, if not at Winterfell, his powers are definitely going to grow exponentially next season, and if the battle's taking place closer to Winterfell, I definitely think Bran may take, you know, safety inside Winterfell's walls for the time being, at least before, you know, if they do lose the battle, obviously the walls will be taken down. But I think Bran will try to take refuge in the Godswood. This maybe even enhances power because we do know that Bran grew up in Winterfell, and a lot of the Starks, Ned included, used to go and pray by these weirwood trees that were present in the Godswood. So with that being said, I think Bran will have to go and try to work into
either creatures or different bites, anything that's close to the Night King, and try to take them out that way, and then maybe he'll try to attempt to work into the Night King himself. Either way, Bran will play a major role in finally defeating the Night King. So I think it's safe to say that this image of an eye is a version of the original Green Seer that helped in the first Long Night. So with this new one coming up, Bran represents that eye, because Bran is now Bloodraven. Another character, I think the middle one, throw your tinfoil cap on me for a second, but I think the middle one may actually be Arya. Now here's why. If you look at all of the other faces, you can actually see like clear expressions. The one who was supposed to be Jaime, he has like this gasping look on his face like he's just seen some ish. And then the guy in the middle is clearly missing a face. There's just some lines drawn across the top of it where eyes would normally be. And then if you look to the one on the far right, I think what the image is trying to say is that that person has a prominent brow. But this person in the middle is most likely Jon Snow, just because we know that Jon Snow is shorter than a lot of the other two characters, so I think they are. You know, Kit Harington is, I think he's like 5'8". But either way, for the tinfoil version, this could actually be Arya. The fact that they're missing a face could represent the fact that Arya is a faceless man. And if you'll notice, they're holding a dagger. Is that dagger Cat's Paw dagger? I don't exactly know about that. And I kind of want to back down because, like I said, it's super tinfoily. But just imagine, if Jon Snow were to actually die in the battle, like maybe the final blow to the Night King is delivered by Jon, so technically he killed him, but the Night King pulls one of those poetic justice in, like, it's a definitely a Hollywood stereotype in movies where the bad guy and the good guy goes out at the same time. They end up stabbing each other. So who's to say he doesn't form his hand or something into an ice spear and stab Jon Snow through the heart, just as Jon Snow stabs him with his Valyrian steel sword. Now remember, this is supposed to be a shot of, in my opinion, what's left after the battle. The few people that are left up behind, our main three heroes up front, are also some individuals who had heavy hands in it. One of those people being Jaime Lannister. But for up front, if this is Arya, and this is a shot of after the battle, Jon Snow would of course passed away, and this could be Arya, who's also smaller than the two individuals who are on the left and on the right, would be in the middle holding the Cat's Paw dagger, which could have been used to deliver the final blow to the Night King, and then she picks it up after Jon Snow drops. But not to worry, Jon Snow has a group called the Fiery Hand to help him get resurrected. Now I know you're probably wondering, what is the Fiery Hand? And if you know who the Fiery Hand is, then you're probably like, I doubt they'll be showing up. They may. If you want to know more about my thoughts on that, you can actually click right here, and that'll take you to a video I did about a month back where I explain who the Fiery Hand is and how I think they may play a role in Season 8. But to summarize, I think that if Melisandre goes to Volantis and she's successful in convincing the Red Priests and Priestesses at the Fire Temple in Volantis, if she's able to convince them that, hey, not only is Daenerys a potential Azor Ahai, but also Jon Snow is. And the prophecy may apply to both of them. Yes, Daenerys has fire, but Jon Snow has been resurrected. He's the chosen one of the Lord of Light. So if she's successful in her mission, and she's able to bring back some of these Fiery Hand individuals, they could actually have the potential of resurrecting Jon Snow and any of his fallen comrades. Before we move forward, I want to mention something that I forgot to mention in my most recent Arya video. I definitely think that people have an issue with the fact that Arya was able to hold her own when fighting Brienne. I've explained this before during Season 7, and I'll quickly explain it again right now. Arya's been training all 7 seasons. Now, I know there's only been one or a few years that have passed since the very beginning of Game of Thrones on the TV show, but in all actuality, we know that, you know, TV land can manipulate time however they want to, and technically I think Arya's got several solid years of training under her belt. People tend to think that just because they don't show it on screen, it doesn't happen, but when it comes to characters dying like Stannis, just because they didn't show it, there's a glimmer of hope that he's still alive. Arya has been training the entire time since Season 1. Whether we see her doing it in the morning when she wakes up or not, she's training. She's been trained in 3 different fighting styles, and she can definitely hold her own against Brienne. I was a little bit tedious trying to rack my brain to figure out who these other two characters are, those being the outside, because I think the center character who's smaller than the two outer characters could either be Jon Snow or Arya, but I think the far left character is Sandor Clegane. And the reason why I say this is because he tends to stand taller than everyone else. He's also got the broad shoulders, and he's got these two little dots around his leg, which, if we remember, Sandor had his leg hurt really bad, and that was almost the cause of his death when he got pushed off the mountain by Brienne. But if you'll notice, there's a little Theta symbol underneath him, which in Game of Thrones represents It's a little bit murky on the interpretation of the Game of Thrones version, but I think, you know, it's one of the first symbols that we see way back in season one, and we see it multiple times throughout the entire series. And I think the true definition of what it means for the world of A Song of Ice and Fire is yet to been 100% determined. But in all actuality, in the real world, the Theta was used like in ancient times as sort of like a resurrection symbol. So let's just adapt that version just for this theory. The fact that it's connected to Sandor Clegane could actually mean that he falls in battle and then Beric Dondarrion gives him the Kiss of Life to resurrect him. Okay, now backtracking a bit here, back to the scene with Arya, Sandor, and Brienne. Making these videos really does light my brain up, but the fact that Arya, Brienne, and Sandor were involved in a scene in which Sandor was pushed off a mountain and almost died could in fact be foreshadowing to the fact that Brienne and Arya may play a hand in Clegane Bowl 2.0 in Season 8. Okay, now continuing on with the Theta explanation. The reason why I say this is because Beric actually does this to Lady Stoneheart in the novels to allow her to live. So it's definitely, if Beric is still alive and he survived being blown up at the wall with undead Viserion, then it's a possibility that he may give his life to resurrect someone like Sandor. Now, it may actually happen in the first battle, so the fact that this Theta symbol, which, you know, in ancient times in the real world meant resurrection, the fact that it's connected to the character who I think is Sandor, that's why I think that Sandor may fall in battle and is saved by Beric. And he has this symbol touching him, so I think that means that he was already resurrected before he went into this battle. So that means he may have fallen in the first battle, and then Beric saves him during that. Just think about how poetic that is. If you remember, one of the first times we see an interaction between Sandor and Beric, Sandor splits him in half, and then Sandor is able to go free, even though some of the crimes that he committed he should have to pay for. And then the very next time he sees him, he's joining him in Season 6, and then in Season 7, Sandor's fully convinced that there is, you know, maybe not necessarily a Lord of Light, but there is something out there, and he can see it in the flames. So the fact that Beric's final gift to Sandor is giving him that extra life, I think that'll be the full push that Sandor needs to realize that he was meant for something greater. Okay, so I keep talking about these two battles. Let me go ahead and spit it out at you guys. All right, so the reason why I think there are going to be two battles, wait, before I go any further, let me throw up a spoiler warning because I am in fact using known filming spoilers to influence my theorizing in this next part. So go ahead and click out of this video right now if you don't want to know anything about the filming or any kind of spoilers for Game of Thrones Season 8. I'll see you in the next one, and just slap a like on this video. Make sure you leave a comment down below and then click that gleam.io link so you can go check out the giveaway. We were recently told by Watchers on the Wall that there were two minor cast members filming in Wintertown, which was actually going to be the very first scene, the opening scene of Game of Thrones Season 8, the final season of our beloved TV show. So, with that being said, there were also, you know, a day later it was announced that Kit Harington was in Ireland, and then Peter Dinklage was actually in Ireland as well. And that's Tyrion and Jon Snow. I'm sure most of you know that. But it was also noted that Jon Snow had already flown back to LA, so he may have filmed something quickly and then wrapped it up. The fact that we were told in the first report that that opening scene only involves minor characters doesn't really mean too much, because we know a lot of major characters, when they're in a scene, it takes place indoors because they want, you know, that seclusion of us really only focusing on them. Now, a lot of the scenes will take place outdoors, but just because those main cast members weren't seen filming with the minor cast members, it does not mean that they aren't involved in those scenes. I don't exactly see any time being wasted. We're going to have 6 episodes, and those episodes may be a feature length, or they may only be, you know, 55 minutes, and then part of that time, part of that runtime is actually just catch up, flashbacks, and then behind the scenes, like after the episode kind of stuff. So with that being said, I don't think they're going to waste too much screen time on trying to drag out plot lines. So I think Daenerys and Jon Snow are going to arrive in Winterfell episode 1. And the fact that Peter Dinklage and Tyrion is the same person, but the fact that Peter Dinklage and Jon Snow were seen filming or arriving in Belfast, which we know is a fact where the Northern Studio is, that means they were most likely filming indoors. I predict they may arrive at Winterfell first episode and we get a battle. Long story short, that battle does not go too well. Everyone is dispersed everywhere. It gives them a chance to kind of spread out and then slow the season down for a little bit, because you know they like to open up with a bang the first second episode. There'll probably be a battle. And then for episode 3, 4, and part of 5, we'll see some conclusion for a lot of the main story. We'll probably see a lot of other side characters die in those first 2 episodes, so they're kind of going to give us a chance to catch our breath and slow down and even ourselves out for the season and then end it with a bang in episode 6. And that first battle could likely happen right as we're expecting the famous Game of Thrones awkward introduction / awkward meal. Now, there were several awkward meals with Sam Tarly and his family, and then there was another, one of my favorite awkward meals, was when Sansa first meets back up with Jon Snow in Game of Thrones Season 6 when she's having that dinner with Dolores Edd. I actually theorized that she was going to have a relationship with Dolores Edd. I don't necessarily know if that still may happen. I think that she may end up with Tyrion, but if it's not that type of story where they don't have these political alliances at the end of the series, and that kind of doesn't really mean anything, and everyone or people who are left alive can maybe have that free will of choice of kind of marry who they want to. Sansa was kind of smirking at Dolores Edd, so there's still that chance, but we all know Dolores Edd is likely going to die early on. So that awkward introduction could get cut short when we have the Night King or some of his troops showing up ahead of time. I don't think he's going to go all in, because if he went all in the first battle, then our heroes would likely die right away. But I think he's going to send part of his troops just enough to have Winterfell overrun, and then Winterfell literally falls to winter, having an opposite effect of what happened before, where the last Long Night was supposedly defeated. Also, there's something I forgot to mention. When this scene actually takes place, remember, it's in episode 4, so it's before Daenerys actually goes north of the wall. But at the very end, when Jon finishes showing her all the different carvings that he found while they were mining for a dragonglass, he says that, you know, the worst threat that everyone's facing is this image right here, and that was a shot of the Night King. Daenerys says, you know, this is before she sees the dead, so she's like, I can do this, you'll have my support, but I need you to bend the knee. Jon Snow mentions that he can't bend the knee, the main reason being is because his people would never accept a southern ruler, especially now that he's been declared King of the North. So that's going to be weighing heavy on everyone's minds going into Game of Thrones Season 8, but like I just mentioned, that's not going to matter because that introduction and Daenerys being accepted is going to be broken up by this insane battle to open up the final season of Game of Thrones. We all know history is going to repeat itself, but with this last season, we have to do some Inception-type stuff and reverse that. So yes, history is repeating itself, but this time, the bad guys will win. Also, blowing out expectations, you know, keeping in theme with the tune of the show, would be to immediately end that awkward introduction and not have it long and drawn out. I want to thank you all so much for watching. If you could please slap a like on this video, the like goal will be 420. Also, leave a comment down below and let me know what you think about my theory here. Do you think it's a possibility that these 3 figures that we were shown, well lit up enough, actually mean something? Or do you think that one of the images of maybe the Night King meant more? I really didn't discuss that other image too much in this video because I kind of think that was what it was, which was basically the Night King up front. You can see one of these people has the crown, and then the ones behind them are holding very similar weapons to the White Walkers, so there's not much to be discussed there. The other image I feel is more important, so you guys let me know your thoughts on that down below in the comment section. If you would like to be entered into my contest to win this lovely $20 Amazon gift card, all you have to do to enter that contest is click the gleam.io link down below and make sure you enter all those ways, and also leave a comment. Make sure you like this video and then subscribe. I want to give a super special thank you to every single member of my Patreon family. My name's Mark, and this has been Sir Hunts Reviews.